I loved all the experiences, but I think the first was just the most magical because, well, it was the first time. And we had no idea it was going to be as successful as it was, but we were all shooting in Santa Rosa, California, which is north of San Francisco. Really beautiful area. And it was an odd experience because you're obviously shooting nights the entire time, so it was a bit like being vampires. But we had great fun, you know. We were all very new to the business. I'd been on Party of Five. Courtney had been on Friends for a year. I'd been on the show for a year. And Drew was really the biggest name. Everybody else, you know, none of us really had names yet. So it was exciting for all of us. Very new. You know, the final sequence of the first Scream took about 3 weeks. But it was great fun. I think Matt Lillard and Jamie Kennedy and Skeet were all fantastic in their energy in it. So we had a lot of fun shooting it. Most mortifying one was actually, I think, having to do that singing, the one where my boyfriend sings to me in the second the second movie. For some reason, I found that very embarrassing. But most fun, I don't know if I have one moment that was most fun. I think the cast, we all had a blast together all the time. Wes Craven was always in his seat giggling. Because he's twisted and wonderful.
So but you're not a fan of being serenaded then? Is there anyone here fancy serenading?
No, please, thank you.
Yeah, what was it like to work with Wes Craven?
Gosh, he's phenomenal. I mean, he really obviously knows his stuff and has such a passion for this genre and has a great sense of humor, and I think that's why he's able to make such good movies within this genre. I think you have to have a sense of humor within it. He gets such glee out of being disgusting. But he's great. He's just an amazing person and a very, very good director for actors as well. He really helped me a lot to get into moments when I was, when I was tired or trying to get my energy out, because obviously with that character is a lot of heightened energy. And he was great.
Did you always like to know the killer up front, or was it a surprise at the end? Or
I always knew. They felt that it was important that I know. But on, I think, on 3 and 4, they didn't tell the rest of the cast. Which was an interesting choice, but it worked. I think they also just didn't want it to get leaked.
What's your favorite scary movie?
The Changeling with George C. Scott. I think it was made in the 70s, and it's absolutely terrifying. It's not a film that everybody knows about, but it's really great.
That's a while back, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Did you see that at a very young age? Was it?
I saw it at, it was the first horror film I ever saw. I think I was 11 years old, and I was at a friend's house for a sleepover, and I had nightmares for a month after that. So. My favorite death in Scream? I think people like the Rose McGowan one. Where her head goes, she goes up in the, I don't know if you know, where she gets killed in the garage door. It's pretty twisted. People wonder whether I regret, I don't regret in any sense doing the Scream movies. They've done phenomenal things for my career. And at points in my career, I think it hindered me in certain ways when maybe someone wouldn't cast me because I was so well known at that moment for Scream. Yeah. And the energy was so toward that. But at the same time, I can't regret it. It's been incredible for me, and they're great movies, and there's a great audience, and people love them. And I've gotten past that now, too, I think. So I don't think there should be fear about doing it. And, in acting, it used to be if you were in films, you didn't do TV. If you were in TV, you wanted to do film. But there's such a crossover now of the mediums, and I think crossover of genres as well now, so.
Scary
movies.
Yeah, and the portrayal of your characters in that.
Were you offended, or did you go and see it and just laugh?
To be honest, I've only seen 40 minutes of the first one, but I thought it was very funny, and I know people really loved them, and I'm happy for the company that made so much money on them. It was great. And what is it they say? Mockery or what? Imitation is the greatest form of flattery.
Absolutely.
So there you go. I got to go with that.
I think that's the right attitude, isn't it? Yeah.
Which one would you prefer, the Scream movie with Tori Spelling or the scary movie that you only seen 40 minutes?
Well, I've only seen 40 minutes, so it's hard to say. I thought, you know what, Tori had such a great sense of humor doing that, I think. I thought it was very brave of her to do that, because in some sense it was making fun of her career in a way. And she's actually a really nice girl and actually quite bright, so I have to go for that one.
Will there be a Scream 5?
You know, I have no idea what the answer is to that question. I think initially the intention with the fourth Scream was that it be a new trilogy. But I think they had hoped that the film would do better than it did. And they've gone and made the television series, which has just come out now. So I'm not sure that it would make sense to go back to a film. But you never know with the Weinsteins. I mean, they could decide tomorrow that they want to do it. And I, you know, I don't know where we would go with it. We'd have to come up with something really good. Because otherwise it might be a bit repetitive. I have not seen the Scream TV show. I've been asking people as they come up to me here, you know, who've seen it, what they think, and it seems to be some mixed reviews. But, you know, sometimes it takes a show a while to get a rhythm going, and maybe it'll end up being wonderful. I will see it, because, you know, Wes is involved, and I'm sure a few people are going to ask me about it. So I have a three-year-old. I don't have a lot of time to watch TV. So, and The Craft was great fun. I mean, it was my first feature film in America. The girl, Rachel, True and I became very dear friends, and Robin, everyone was really great, and it's funny, it's become such a cult hit. We actually, they do these screenings in the Hollywood Cemetery every month in the summer, or every week in the summertime, and they did it was 20-year reunion screening of The Craft, and they had 5,000 people there, everybody in costumes, and the four girls, we all went and attended it, and it was great. It was great fun.
What was your best memories on Wild Things?
From Wild Things?
Yes.
Working with Bill Murray. You know, he's such a legend and so hilarious. And I had great fun with him. He decided, when we were doing the courtroom scenes, he decided that he would go out and buy the music to Party of Five, and he picked me up and threw me on his shoulder and had a ghetto blaster, playing playing the Party of Five theme song, and decided to traipse me around in front of all the extras trying to mortify me. So he was good fun to be around.
Three to Tango is one of my favorite, top five rom-coms. Can you make three sounds at once?
You're a good sport. So what was it like working with the comic strip guys?
Fantastic. It was really, I wasn't that aware of their work. And then obviously when I was given the offer, I had a look and I thought it was ridiculous and wonderful. And I love the British sense of humor, you know. So we had a blast. I mean, Christian Slater and I kept looking at each other like, what are we doing in this movie? It's so odd. And the comedians in it were like, what are you guys doing in this movie? We're like, I don't know, but it's fun. So it was good. And we shot in Devon, which was lovely. It was really beautiful.
And for those who don't know, did anyone see that?
No, that's quite unknown.
You have to explain what your role was.
I played Queen Elizabeth when she was 18. Who's
the Hollywood version.
Yeah, the Hollywood version.
Of our dear Queen.
Yeah, and Christian Slater plays the Hollywood version of Churchill.
It's very
and we
funny.
Fall in love.
Yeah, no, that was a lovely one to be involved in, I'm sure.
What was your experience like working on The Company?
I'm sure nobody here has seen The Company. A few people have seen it. The Company was a phenomenal experience. I had been a dancer. That was my first career. I was a classical ballet and contemporary and modern dancer. And it was my dream. And I'd been developing it for 8 years. And I managed to get Robert Altman to direct it, which was incredible. And he's obviously a phenomenal director. So it was magical for everybody, for the dancers. I was dancing with the Joffrey Ballet, and they had never been in a film before, and Robert Altman was like a kid in a candy store, and the crew had never seen dance before, so they were quite amazed as well. So it was a new experience for everyone. And for me, it was magical because I was getting to work with choreographers that I dreamt of working with since I was a child, and got to dance with the Joffrey, which was incredible. So it was great. I started dancing when I was 6. I'd seen the Nutcracker Ballet, and my dad bought me ballet lessons for Christmas. And I started dancing, and then I got accepted to the National Ballet School of Canada when I was 9 years old. And they usually audition about 2,000 kids a year and take 30, so it was a big deal. And it's quite intense, that school. Wonderful. The training is incredible. It's like top three in the world or something. So, you know, I would dance from 8 in the morning till 7 in the evening. I'd do academics and dance from 9 years old. And then when I was 14, I decided to leave the school. I was one of two people to leave the school in 50 years. I wasn't happy with the attitude there. And I quit because I just wanted to be a normal kid. I was missing that experience. And then
you actually had professional engagements during that period.
We would do the Nutcracker Ballet with the National Ballet of Canada. And then when I quit the school when I was 14, some girlfriends of mine, I still took dance classes, and some girlfriends of mine said they were going to go audition for Phantom of the Opera. And I was like, what's Phantom of the Opera? I had no idea what it was. And they're like, well, we're going to go audition. I thought, well, I talked to my mom about it, and she said, well, why don't you go audition for Audition Experience? And I said, okay. And I went in, and they had a few thousand people from America and Canada auditioning, and I ended up becoming one of the 6 ballet chorus, and to me it was such a joke because they kept calling my name, and I'd get cut. I mean, I'd get brought to the next level, the next level, the next level, and I kind of couldn't believe it. And I had, as a joke, brought a song because I never thought I would get to that level. I brought Coco's Tit Willow from The Mikado, which is not a song you would sing in an audition. That ended up being my audition song, and I think they found it funny. And it was Hal Prince directing. So, I mean, it was a phenomenal experience. The majority of the cast were about 10 to 30 years older than me, and it was the original Canadian cast of Phantom of the Opera, and that was my first job, and it was a real coup, and I learned so much from everybody that I worked with.
And
so.
When was the move to America?
The move to America was after I did Phantom, and I'd done a series in Canada, and I'd done a few films. I moved I came to America, I think I was 19 years old, and my girlfriend Tara Strong had said, come out, and some producers on a movie I'd done for NBC had said, you should go to LA and get an agent and get a manager. And I thought, well, okay. I mean, dancing was still my passion. You know, the acting kind of just happened, and I didn't want to quit dance, but I'd had a lot of injuries. So I came to LA, and it happened to be 2 weeks after the big earthquake, and all the agencies were shut, and I couldn't get in the door anywhere. And there was a woman named Arlene Forrester who had just left a big agency at the time called Triad, and she was trying to be a manager, and she said, you know, I hear you're looking for an agent and a manager. Why don't you let me send you out on a few things while you're looking? And I said, okay. And she sent me out on 2 things, and one was Party of 5. I'm one of those people actors hate. Because it seems like the story...
Kind of falling into
It seems like the stories in Hollywood are either you work 20 years and it finally happens, and there's also lots of stories where it's just right place, right time. This is my first American job. I'm Canadian, and I had been working for 6 years already in Canada, and I think I was 20 when I got Party of 5. And it was just a really magical experience in the sense that the cast... I think everyone had a good amount of talent. We really did look like siblings. We felt like siblings. The writing, Chris Kaiser and Amy Littman were fantastic writers. And it's funny, we got the Golden Globe in the first year, which we had not expected. I think we sort of came out of nowhere, and it pissed a few people off. No, it was a show about... a family of siblings who've lost their parents and how they stay together. So a comedy. That was a joke. but no, it was a great experience. The biggest learning experience. I feel like I'm always learning. I'm not sure there's any one experience. You know, it was good when I was talking about this yesterday to someone when I was doing Phantom of the Opera. I was coming up to renewing my contract for a third year, and the cast, because they were older than me, gave me great advice, which was to leave, because I was so young. You know, I'm really, like Colm Wilkinson, I don't know if you guys know who he's phenomenal Irish performer, and he was our Phantom of the Opera, and he had said, you know, Nev, you need to move on, don't get stuck in one thing, because you could, and that show did go for 11 years, I could have gone from 15 years old to 26, and I don't know that it would have been easy to start a career after that, you know, so I think you have to be really conscious about the decisions that you make, but at the same time, don't analyze too much, don't, you know, be fearless in a sense. I've had great advice from a lot of people. But I do feel like I'm constantly learning. You're never going to be perfect, right? You just got to keep trying. So. I was living in London for 8 years and absolutely loved it here. And then at some point, my agents were like, do you care at all about your American profile? So I thought, okay, I should probably go back for a bit. I've been in LA now for 4 years, and we just want to be closer to... We want to do theater, and we want to do... Because J.J. Field is my partner, and he's an actor as well. And we're writing a series at the moment, and we want to be closer to family. His family are in London. I've got friends in London. My family are in Toronto, which is an hour from New York. So I want to be closer to family, especially now that we have a child. So,
if you weren't acting, is there anything else you'd like to do?
I used to think I'd want to be a therapist. I don't know, I'm fascinated
by
people.
What kind?
Well, my mom was a therapist, I guess all a psychologist. I don't know, I'm fascinated by people. But really writing, and I'm doing that now. I'm actually writing as well, so it's still in the arts, isn't
it? Can you say what are you writing with your partner without giving the details away?
You know,
what sort of piece?
We're developing a series based on the Veterans Association in America.
Okay.
And what's going on, you know, the good that they're doing and the challenges that they have as well, and about our soldiers in America and where they're being failed and where they're being helped, and there's a lot of change that needs to happen, so it's based around that.
Is this spurred on from some personal connection, or is it just something you're interested in?
No, it's, you know, JJ had post-traumatic stress from witnessing someone die in front of him in a car accident. And he dealt with a lot of that, and he was able to get through it. And then we kept hearing all these stories about soldiers in America and the amount of PTSD they're suffering from and lack of help. Mm. Not that the VA isn't trying, it's just the system has failed in a sense. So that's sort of where it stemmed from for us. And I just kept hearing stories about the vets and how much homelessness there is in Los Angeles with veterans, and it's pretty appalling. So we wanted to tell some stories. We've gotten to know a lot of vets and their families over the last few years, so we're basing it on their stories.
We wish you well with that project. Mm-hmm. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Neve Campbell.
Thank you guys so much. I really appreciate it.